was stoned by the Jews, and the Jews were never accused of violence or hate. He was stoned in Boston by the Jews, and the Jews never were accused of violence and hate. The man hadn't done anything, but he wanted to make a speech. Yet any time a Muslim or a black man, he doesn't have to be a Muslim, stands up here in America and mentions that it's time for him to try and defend himself, not from someone's doctrine, but from the actual violence that is committed against him, then that black man is accused of being violent. And just because we remind the public of the crimes that were committed against our people here in America during slavery, we're accused of advocating a hate campaign. But right now you turn on your television, your radio, and all of your press, and you'll see nothing on there about Eichmann and what the Germans did to the Jews 1,000 years ago. No. And yet the Jews aren't accused of carrying on a hate campaign.
Mr. X, you talk at great length and monopolize a considerable amount of time. However, I would like to say that one of the things that was in Mr. Lincoln's book that intrigued me was the fact that this Muslim movement is run as a kind of a dictatorship itself. There haven't been any elections. People are tried without having anything to say about it, and cast into the outer limbo. Women are disubordinated and have no voice within the movement. Now, that doesn't seem to me like something new in the world. It seemed to me to be pretty reactionary.
You wrote in the Pittsburgh Courier, Mr. Scholar, about the Muslim movement yourself on May the 30th, 1959, at which time you said, from what I have seen and heard about the program of the black Muslims in this country in the past few years, I conclude that there is much to commend it to other sects and religious groups, many of whom seem to be distressingly unwitting in their way.
I just said that.
You also pointed out that not only do the Muslims believe in it, meaning this economic progress, but they are doing it. They are not only preparing and serving their food, but they are growing it. This is what you wrote. You says that you also said, we are alone in not doing this in regard to setting up economic enterprises for ourselves, so we are always rattling the tin cup and begging for succor.
Now, you see, that's what you get for trying to be nice. Now, I just told Mr. X here a little while ago that this was a part of the Muslim movement which I commended very highly. You don't have to go back to what I wrote a year or so ago. I said that this afternoon, and I say it again. But you haven't dealt with the issue that I raised about the Muslim movement being dictatorial itself.
It's because we have unity. Because we have complete unity, and again, the worst critics of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad give him credit for establishing better discipline and unity among his followers than has ever been established among any so-called Negroes in America. And anytime there is unity in any country that has a philosophy or a doctrine or an aim that's in opposition to the power existing bloc.
Mr. Scholar wants to come in, and we have to move on to another point. Mr. Scholar, do you want to drop this point now? I don't think you men are going to agree.
Well, of course, we'll never agree, and I won't drop it, but I will not want to monopolize the time.
Mr. Scholar has made an issue about our religion, and about the Muslims being the one who created all this. He has made an issue about our religion.
Pardon me, I must call you to order here. Mr. Schuyler has dropped the point so that we can move to something else. I want to bring Mr. Baldwin in here, if I may, because I've been very much interested in your articles in Harper's and the Times and so forth, in which you explain the whole Negro mood, part of which is expressed through the black Muslims, as in part a reaction to world events, particularly Africa. And this is a new Negro, you say. Now, in these terms, It's quite interesting to me to read of the alleged connections between the black Muslims and the Muslims in Africa and between the black Muslims and the Castro movement in Cuba. Do you know anything about this?
No, I don't know anything about that in detail. But I know nothing about the Muslim movement in Africa at all, so I can't talk about that.
Well, of course, it is making great progress in Africa,
yes,
as you know.
I know that.
Do you see this as a worldwide movement at all, which would appeal to the Negro?
Well, how can I put it? You know, it seems to me to be arguing in a way almost after the fact. But if you're talking about power, it is very, very clear that the Western nations, the white nations, that power is broken. The connection between Cuba and American Negroes I can see very well, because the way that the United States' role in Cuba are exactly analogous in the mind of any Negro living in this country to the situation he finds himself in here. Now, again, I have to come back to this point. We are really talking about power, and we cannot argue with the Muslim movement in those terms because, I repeat this, they are only imitating. They are simply doing the same thing that the white world has done for all these years. Now, that must be my objection to the Muslim movement. It seems to me that what we in this country do not know and have not faced is that we can very well isolate ourselves on this continent because the world is no longer white at all. We do not know what to do this in the first place. What are we talking about? I think that Malcolm, Mr. X, and I don't agree, entirely agree with Mr. Schuyler either, or white Americans. I don't know what white men have in the first place, which is so desirable. I don't know why it's so important to be white anymore. It seems to me the civilization, which we are now witnessing in a way, if not the end of, the great transformation of, can only be saved by us in this country if we're willing to do something which we have not done.
What would we do, Mr. Baldwin, in your opinion? Do you favor the black Muslim program, or do you favor the program of, let us say, the NAACP?
Well, I think,
I'm trying to get this.
I think the NAACP program is probably outmoded because when you have a situation where the legality of a country is in question, then one does not know what is legal anymore. One has got to revise the entire system.
Well, the NAACP says what is legal is the integration of American life.
What is legal then? What is legal then in Mississippi?
Integration of American life.
How does one achieve it then in Mississippi?
The NAACP says you keep trying until you achieve.
And Mr. X responds that
he's impatient.
Mr. X responds and says he will not wait 100 years.
Oh, he says something else. He says he doesn't want it either.
I say, wait a moment. No, don't say what I say. I say that the black masses themselves in America are impatient. And that the white man does not know how the black masses think any more than he knew how the peasants in Cuba thought when he went in there and thought that they would rise up inside with him.
Well, now, you said the white man does not know, and I'm sure I don't know.
He doesn't know,
I
sir. He's not being told by his so-called Negro advisors, or the ones that he has set up as spokesmen for the so-called Negro.
Well, these so-called advisors, I thought were men of some knowledge about the Negro community.
They now live in the Negro community.
Ralph Bunche has denounced you as a totally escapist movement. Roy Wilkins, Executive Secretary of the NAACP, says you are preaching pure hatred. Thurgood Marshall called you such violent names, I won't repeat them
here. May I answer to each one of those?
And President Martin Luther King says you are simply one of the hate groups arising in our midst. I think all of that.
Wait a moment, sir. I think that in fairness, since these things that you read to your audience, in order for you to be fair, I have to make my comment.
Go ahead.
Number one, these so-called Negro leaders that made these statements, it's contrary to our policy ever to attack anyone personally, only in defense. And I think that each one that you read off, you couldn't find them in Harlem. The only time you ever see any one of those that are made spokesmen by you, parrots by the white man, you never find them in Harlem. You find them at the Waldorf Astoria. And so far as them knowing how the black man out there in the street thinks, all you have to do is do like John Griffin, this white man who posed as a Negro did for 6 weeks. He was a pseudo-Negro, and yet he comes back today, and he's an expert on how a Negro is supposed to feel. And we've been black all of our lives, and when we step up and try and tell you how a black man who is born black feels, you think that we're haters or racist or something of that sort. And I think that it's bringing injustice to the public.
Yes, I'm from Harlem, too. I was born in those streets and raised in them, and I think I know something about it, too. All of the condemnations from Mr. Bunche, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, are all far too simple. The challenge that this movement represents, and I think it's very misleading to think about it simply as a movement, the challenge this movement represents has nothing to do with what they call themselves or even what their aims are, whether Mr. X is willing to say what their aims are or whether or not we know. The challenge this movement represents is finally whether or not this country means to be what it says it is. Are we free or are we not? And we can only decide this one way. If the country wants to be free, then it has got to do something to prove it. And as long as we're not willing to do it, then the Muslim movement will gain more and more and more ground, and not only here, but all over the world. If we say, I think we should put the governor of Mississippi in jail, as opposed to putting harmless people who challenge House Un-American Activities Committee in jail. I think that what has got to decide...
Mr. Baldwin, I still don't have clear whether you favor the Black Muslim program or the NAACP program two different approaches.
Well, I will not answer it that way. I certainly don't favor the Black Muslim movement. But I can see great limits.
You see why it came about.
I can see very well why it came about.
I think Mr. Lincoln has explained in his book very well why it came about.
I don't think...